Harper Audio presents Island Beneath the Sea by Isabel Allende, performed by Epatha Merkerson. Copyright 2010 by Isabel Allende. Production copyright 2010 by HarperCollins Publishers. Zarite. In my 40 years, I, Zarite Sideya, have had better luck than other slaves. I am going to have a long life, and my old age will be a time of contentment because my star, mes étoiles, also shines when the night is cloudy. I know the pleasure of being with the man my heart has chosen. His large hands awaken my skin. I have had 4 children and a grandson, and those who are living are free. My first memory of happiness, when I was just a bony, runny-nosed, tangled-haired little girl, is moving to the sound of the drums. And that is also my most recent happiness, because last night I was in the Place Congo, dancing and dancing without a thought in my head. And today, my body is warm and weary. Music is a wind that blows away the years, memories, and fear, that crouching animal I carry inside me. With the drums, the everyday Zarite disappears, and I am again the little girl who danced when she barely knew how to walk. I strike the ground with the soles of my feet, and life rises up my legs, spreads up my skeleton, takes possession of me, drives away distress, and sweetens my memory. The world trembles. Rhythm is born on the island beneath the sea. It shakes the earth. It cuts through me like a lightning bolt and rises toward the sky, carrying with it my sorrows so that Papa Bon Dieu can chew them, swallow them, and leave me clean and happy. The drums conquer fear. The drums are the heritage of my mother, the strength of Guinea that is in my blood. No one can harm me when I'm with the drums. I become as overpowering as Urzuli, Loa of love, and swifter than the bullwhip. The shells on my wrists and ankles click in time. The gourds ask questions. The djembe drums answer in the voice of the jungle and the timbales with their 10 tones. The junjuns that know how to speak make the invitation. And the big maman roars when they beat her to summon the loas. The drums are sacred. The loas speak through them. In the house where I spent my earliest years, the drums were silent in the room we shared with Honoré, the other slave, but they were often taken out. Madame Delphine, my mistress then, did not want to hear the black's noise, only the melancholy laments of her clavichord. Mondays and Tuesdays, she gave classes to girls of color, and the rest of the week, she taught in the mansions of the Grand Blanc, where the mademoiselles had their own instruments, because they could not use the ones the mulatta girls touched. I learned to clean the keys with lemon juice, but I could not make music, because Madame Delphine forbade us to go near her clavichord. We didn't need it. Honoré could draw music from a cook pot. Anything in his hands had beat, melody, rhythm, and voice. He carried sounds inside his body. He had brought them from Dahomey. My toy was a hollow gourd we made to rattle. Later, he taught me to caress his drums slowly. And from the beginning, when he was still carrying me around in his arms, he took me to dances and voodoo services where he marked the rhythm with his drum, the principal drum, for others to follow. This is how I remember it. Honoré seemed very old to me because his bones had frozen stiff, even though at the time he was no older than I am now. He drank tafia in order to endure the pain of moving, but more than that harsh rum, music was the best remedy. His moans turned to laughter with the sound of the drums. Honoré barely could peel sweet potatoes for the mistress's meal, his hands were so deformed. But playing the drum, he never got tired. And when it came to dancing, no one lifted his knees higher or swung his head with more force or shook his behind with more pleasure. Before I knew how to walk, he had me dance sitting down. And when I could just balance myself on two legs, he invited me to lose myself in the music the way you do in a dream. Dance. Dance, Zarete. The slave who dances is free while he is dancing, he told me. I have always danced. Part 1. Saint-Domingue. 1770 to 1793. The Spanish Illness. Toulouse Velmorin arrived in Saint-Domingue in 1770, the same year the Dauphin of France married the Austrian Archduchess Marie Antoinette. Before traveling to the colony, when still he had no suspicion that his destiny was going to play a trick on him, or that he would end up in cane fields in the Antilles, he had been invited to Versailles to one of the parties in honor of the new Dauphine, a young blonde of 14 who yawned openly in the rigid protocol of the French court. All of that was in the past. Saint-Domingue was another world. The young Valmorin had a rather vague idea of the place where his father struggled to earn a livelihood for his family with the ambition of converting it into a fortune. Valmorin had read somewhere that the original inhabitants of the island, the Arawaks, had called it Haiti before the conquistadors changed the name to La Española and killed off the natives. And fewer than 50 years, not a single Arawak remained, nor sign of them. They all perished as victims of slavery, European illnesses, and suicide. They were a redskin race, with thick black hair and inalterable dignity, so timid that a single Spaniard could conquer 10 of them with his bare hands. They lived in polygamous communities, cultivating the land with care in order not to exhaust it. Sweet potatoes, maize, gourds, peanuts, peppers, potatoes, and cassava. The earth, like the sky and water, had no owner until the foreigners, using the forced labor of the Arawaks, took control of it in order to cultivate never-before-seen plants. It was in that time that the custom of killing people with dogs was begun. When they had annihilated the indigenous peoples, the new masters imported slaves, blacks kidnapped in Africa, and whites from Europe, convicts, orphans, prostitutes, and rebels. At the end of the 1600s, Spain ceded to France the western part of the island, which they called Saint-Domingue, and which would become the richest colony in the world. At the time Toulouse Velmorin arrived there, a third of the wealth of France in sugar, coffee, tobacco, cotton, indigo, and cocoa came from the island. There were no longer white slaves, but the number of blacks had risen to hundreds of thousands. The most intractable crop was sugarcane, the sweet gold of the colony. Cutting the cane, crushing it, and reducing it to syrup was labor not for humans, as the planters maintained, but for beasts. Valmorin had just turned 20 when he was summoned to the colony by an urgent letter from his father's business agent. When the youth disembarked, he was dressed in the latest fashion, lace cuffs, powdered wig, and shoes with high heels and sure that the books he had read on the subject of exploration made him more than capable of advising his father for a few weeks. He was traveling with a valet nearly as elegant as he, and several trunks holding his wardrobe and his books. He thought of himself as a man of letters and planned upon his return to France to dedicate himself to science. He admired the philosophers and encyclopedists who had in recent decades made such an impact in Europe, and he agreed with some of their liberal ideas. Rousseau's Social Contract had been his bedside book at 18. He had barely got off the ship after a crossing that nearly ended in tragedy when they ran into a hurricane in the Caribbean, when he received his first disagreeable surprise. His progenitor was not waiting for him at the port. He was met by the agent, a courteous Jew, dressed in black from head to foot, who informed him of the precautions necessary for moving about the island. He had brought him horses, a pair of mules for luggage, a guide, and militiamen to accompany him to the Habitation Saint-Lazare. The young man had never set foot outside France, and had paid very little attention to the stories, banal, furthermore, his father used to tell during his infrequent visits to the family in Paris. He could not imagine that he would sometime visit the plantation. The tacit agreement was that his father would consolidate his fortune on the island while he looked after his mother and sisters and supervised the business in France. The letter he had received alluded to health problems, and he supposed that it concerned a passing fever. But when he reached Saint-Lazare, after a day's march at a killing pace through a gluttonous and hostile nature, he realized that his father was dying. He was not suffering from malaria, as Valmoran had thought, but syphilis, le mal espagnol, which was devastating whites, blacks, and mulattoes alike. His father's illness was in the last stages. He was covered with pustules, nearly incapacitated, his teeth were loose, and his mind in a fog. The Dantesque treatments of bloodletting, mercury, and cauterizing his penis with red-hot wire had not given him relief, but he continued them as an act of contrition. Just past his 50th birthday, he had become an ancient, giving nonsensical orders, urinating without control, and passing his time in a hammock with his pets, a pair of young black girls who had barely reached puberty. While slaves unpacked his luggage under the direction of the valet, a fop who barely endured the crossing on the ship and was frightened by the primitive conditions of the place, Toulouse Valmoran went out to look over the vast property. He knew nothing about the cultivation of cane, but the tour was sufficient for him to understand that the slaves were starving and the plantation had been saved from ruin only because the world was consuming sugar with increasing voraciousness. In the account books, he found the explanation for his father's bad financial condition, which was not maintaining his family at a proper level in Paris. Production was a disaster, and the slaves were dying like insects. Valmoran had no doubt that the overseers were robbing his family, taking advantage of the master's deterioration. He cursed his luck and set about rolling up his sleeves and getting to work, something no young man from his milieu ever considered. Work was for a different class of people. He began by obtaining a generous loan, thanks to the support and connections of his father's business agent's bankers. Then he ordered the commandeur to the cane fields to work elbow to elbow with the same people they had martyrized and replaced them with others less depraved. He reduced punishments and hired a veterinarian who spent 2 months at Saint-Lazare trying to return the Negroes to some degree of health. The veterinarian could not save Valmoran's valet, who was dispatched by a fulminating diarrhea in fewer than 38 hours. Valmoran realized that his father's slaves lasted an average of 18 months before they dropped dead of fatigue or escaped, a much shorter period than on other plantations. The women lived longer than the men, but they...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.